So there's other things to talk about with Samuel Jackson.
Yeah. There's also other things to talk about that movie. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Well, he has this weird, he's kind of could be a film critic. He actually, we talked like 20 minutes after the interview and about every movie was out. And like, he had like line notes for every director about how they should have cut this or this scene should be gone. Or it's kind of fascinating. He's an interesting guy. But
it was really interesting
the
point he made about how
he's hanging around and just does, you know, he does like six or seven straight movies a year too. Like movies that
are, you know, make a lot more movies.
And we also encounter,
it's like an obvious thing, but it really.
Many, many styles. We encounter many, many, many styles.
Yeah.
And so how is Kyle, this is a very quiet room we're doing this in, but
I know.
How is Kyle's style?
Kyle is low-key, lethargic, mysterious, non-existent. He stays by Video Village.
Very distant.
Is he there?
I stay in the van.
Is he not
like the
there?
Wachowskis, yeah.
Only to rushes. He won't show up on set. Kind of like Woody Allen, he hides.
Totally.
I made a concerted effort this time to like, I was really chatty with my actors on the first movie and I was like trying to be, I have to work against it so much where I would like give full sentences and I was trying so hard to just be like, if I'm going to like say something, continue to take, to just make it like three or four words. And I don't mean like chatty socially, I mean like
notes. When we were rolling, it was all business.
Yeah, I tried to just be like three or four words in between takes and like that's it. I figured if I can't say it in three or four words, it's not an actual note, you know? Like,
nice.
But I'm sure I screwed that up every once in a while, though. I got nervous.
But there's only so much an actor can synthesize and try to, you know, get into the next take.
You
can overload an actor very easily.
Very easily.
And some directors do that intentionally, I think. Mm-hmm. No, seriously. Like,
I know,
Fincher, he sends you way too many notes that you could possibly, accomplish.
Yeah.
In the effort of sort of getting you out of your own way.
To get you into, like, a state of
hysteria, despair,
total despair. Yeah,
yeah.
Complete so a lot of conversation before you get to set.
Oh, are we recording?
Yes, we're in our.
He's incredibly friendly. He's incredibly articulate. Incredibly voluble. He's fantastic. And
we had very little time. I appreciate it. I mean, we had so little time to like talk before most people came in, because the way it worked is that, like, you know, Jonathan was there the whole time. The first 5 days were Corey. The second week was Denis and Troian, and then like the third, and then the other half week was Denis. And so it was like pretty much like someone would fly in on a Sunday and have like just enough time. I mean, I think we met like at 10 p.m. or something, like just enough time to like talk for a couple hours before the next day. I mean, because it was that kind of a shoot, you know, it came together really quickly and executed really quickly. So Jonathan and I were saying earlier too, it's like discussions before, like to me that is rehearsal. Like I could, running lines before I think would be, for me it feels so uncomfortable. Like, you know, when you're getting ready to do the scene, I get it, but actually like going into a room like months before shooting the movie, I've just never had the opportunity to do it, so I don't know what it's like, but I mean, we did a lot of it on the fly, which for the most part, all worked out really well.
Also, I felt everyone got enough takes. I never felt like a scene wasn't properly covered, or I never felt like we had just warmed up and now we're moving on. It always felt like we got enough takes.
I'm glad to hear that, because we had, I mean, it was like 8-10 page days every day. And Denis, I mean, you had like 7 monologues in a movie, you know?
But it feels very intimate. I mean, it feels very, like, the characters are incredibly well-defined.
Good.
How much of that is the script in a case like this, and how much is the director poking you I mean, I guess he pokes you a little bit.
Well, in this case, it's kind of both, because Kyle adapted the script himself and directed it, and he is very good about defining characters and also creating each world of the character that Jonathan kind of goes in between, so he's... That's kind of a testament to you.
Well, we tried to make it really, it was really, because it's interesting, seeing the movie now, it was like, oh, how is that ever a concern? The concern was always like would John and Curly be too similar of people? Mm-hmm. Like, would it be a different experience for him in some ways? But as soon as it was just like something I was like conscious of in casting, of being like, okay, it's got to be different. Because even in the story, they're almost similar to each other. Mm-hmm. But it changed so much as we were shooting it. Like, Corey's character changed probably the most, I think, just because the tone of it, of the character, just changed. We just changed a lot. We were like going through it, and it just was getting better. And so we
because
were just
that's what Corey bring to it, or because?
I think so. I think it was the two of them. It was written to be a little bit like, it was written, the character's a little goofier initially, like he is in the story. And we shot some stuff that way, and Corey did such a good job with it. But the truth was is that what his character needed in that moment was like actual sexual tension. Like, that's what he needed. He needed to be like confronted with that, and for that to be what slowly changed in the story. Curly's sort of like pushing him and like to get to, like, come over to my house, oh, here, come over to my room. And it's like very like aggressive, and it's almost like David has no choice but to go. And like, that's not ultimately that's really not that interesting to watch on screen, you know, and because it makes him so passive. So the thing that, when you translate it, you know, so the thing that I remember going through was that the scene in the bar when they invite him over, and the scene before where he's like, oh, you want to get a drink? Like, I literally just like flipped a lot of some of the dialogue from the original draft, so that it was like him being like, oh, hey, let's go, let's hang out. And I think that went even more so that, like, when they do walk back into that room, like, we were saying, like, well, what's going through your head? And we're like, what's going through his head is that they're going to have, like, great, you know, great sex right now. You know, like, that had to be that point. It wasn't written that way. So it wasn't written necessarily that way, but as soon as it started working out and you actually see it, it was like, oh, it needed to be that, to be the most interesting version of it.
When he goes home and jerks off, that kind of changes the dynamic in and of itself.
I was saying yesterday how I was so determined to not have a masturbation scene in this movie, since everyone masturbates in my first movie.
You know, I thought it was well done. It was so subtle, and it wasn't like A plus B equals C. You kind of get it. Like, you know, he encounters this guy, but it's very oblique, and then he goes home and the little owls watching is a great touch, but
he was
watching his brain. You know, what the man, and he's living in this incredibly small mobile home. He has no stimulus. He has nothing to do.
I also love that it's night and the trailer is around nothing, yet he still closes the shades.
But you knew
that's totally something I would do.
That was so funny, right?
What also speaks to, I think, his fear when things do become confrontive.
Yeah.
Is that there's, you know, it gives you a picture of his sexuality at that point. You know, even that is like a private, scary thing to do in the trailer.
It was a deliberate thing that, like, the story wasn't working until I sexualized the character, which is kind of it's weird to do that to someone who's like a real person, and it's not necessarily a piece in the story, but it was like, that was like a key element. It's not even in the movie that much, but it was like a key element. Like, one of the last scenes I added in was that first, that, you know, in the script was like that one of the first ones with like that military guy on the bus.
Yeah.
When you give him like a look, you're like, hey, you know, that kind of thing. Like, that was like, I took that chunk off the end of another scene because I saw this guy, he auditioned for like another part, and it was like, oh, this will really work. And so, and it was like, oh, you know, it was that effort to make sure the movie, the undercurrent of the movie was going to be that, like the sort of various forms of sexuality, whether it's attraction or aggression or anger or repression, you know, those with them, it's like, then it needed to be part of who the person was and not just like a back theme, you know?
But one thing that I was really struck with last night seeing the film for the first time was, you know, we've seen a lot of coming out stories.
Yeah.
But like, Jonathan's character is out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's still, it's still not, it's still not enough, you know what I mean? And he still hasn't figured out what that means for him.
But what's really brilliant about that, and what's true to life as a gay person, is that you never come out once.
Hmm.
You
That's
come out every day, today someone said to me, do you want some nail polish for your wife? And I said, I have a husband. But I mean, so you're always coming out, and you watch this guy faced with this world where he doesn't know anybody. As a gay person, sometimes you just don't say anything because it's easier to get along. Mm-hmm. Are you going to really make a statement in a room full of migrant workers when you're sleeping and sharing a room with them? Just keep your mouth shut, keep your head down, and make a friend here and there. Are you really going to come out in a factory?
Yeah.
Are you really going to, you know, this guy's letting you sleep in his basement? Is this the moment to actually make sure they realize that you're gay? As a gay person, gay people understand this the way straight people don't.
Mm. What's interesting is also that everybody reads it and nobody says anything either. I mean, the guys he's doing apples with clearly understand, even though they don't say anything, and you don't understand before.
Oh, I wishful thinking. I think I see it and I
like in denial.
It,
And
I don't want it to be true.
And it's an interesting thing in David's story where like the factory women just like know it, and I find that like an interesting thing when people say it's like, how do you just. I'm always like insecure about that, you know, like how would people know? I mean, I think if I met me, I would know I was gay, but I don't know what it is. I'm like thinking of my hand, you know, I'm like thinking none of those things define that as my sexuality.
I think it's Gary.
I was interested. I think it's Gary. Yeah. But you know, for me, it was, but it was an interesting thing. I think that Denis hit it on the nose. I thought what was the undercurrent for the character for me that I thought was interesting wasn't that he was insecure about being gay, but that he was insecure about what that meant for like his social identity. You know, there's sort of this idealism, I think, I've certainly felt in my life that like, well, I'm not like gay, I'm just attracted to men. Like, it's not like something that's about me, it's just like my sexual preference. But the truth is like those will go hand in hand. I was in denial of that. And I think I definitely tried to put that in there, and I'm glad that it picked up in the film, this idea that like, just because you're comfortable with it, or even like comfortable, you can be social with your friends about it, doesn't mean that you're willing to say, well, it does define me. It did like make my childhood, even if my childhood was great, make it a little more challenging in certain ways, and that eventually it is part of who you are, especially in the nature of where it sort of ends, and the nature that we're still like in a society that treats it as odd. You know?
I love that he tries on identities. You know, he really is kind of tabula rasa in a way. He tries on a Christian identity. He's not faking, he's not lying. Mm-hmm. He's open to the possibility, and he tries to have the conversion experience. He tries it on, and he really feels something. And the movie is wonderful in that way.
It was interesting to me, too, because now reading some of the like responses and reviews, at one point they described you as an ex-girlfriend. We talked about that scene a lot, because to me, it was always just that, like, I know, and it's interesting.
So weird.
And I kind of liked it. I always, when I wrote that scene, it's not in the book at all, and I was like, it's a breakup scene but between, like, two best friends, and, like, mm-hmm. you think, like, what is the difference, like, a gay man who loves a woman who loves him back, and they're best friends, like, what, the only thing that isn't there to be in a relationship is sex, so I thought that was the undercurrent of that scene. It's kind of interesting that people read that as heterosexual. Yeah, I thought that was, it's not the intention, but I think it's interesting that they would.
But accurate, because many times this kind of thing happens, in a way, they have a marriage, and she's holding him back from finding anybody else.
And vice versa, she's just taking the step first, you know?
They have each other, so they don't need anybody else.
And it is very, you know, in that scene, the kind of, you confront me about the sexuality of the relationship, you know,
are you
sleeping, you know, and all this
you're
stuff.
A slut.
And then it gets, you know, and then it gets to the end of it, and he
you're
says,
really a slut? Like,
yeah, but it is a betrayal. We talked about that a lot. It is the betrayal of abandonment, you know, between these two characters that kind of allows you to.
When then I kept on going back and forth. At the end, he goes, "Oh, well, you're never going to find anyone as good as me." And at one point, the scene didn't have her say, "I know." And then we put it back in. I took it out. I put it back in. It was so much better in because it sort of defined it like, "Well, yeah, I know that we're like we'd be great for each other, but hey, it's a little there's this like thing. That's
there's this
always
giant thing
us.
That's going to not work.
Giant thing between us. But it was a
not giant.
Of course, at that age, you never know whether they may have tried it.
Oh, and I always forget that maybe they did. You know, at some point because that's always disastrous and you know, and happens quite frequently. But it was fun for that stuff to be there and to like talk about those things and try to figure it out and try to like put his character sort of like constantly in increasingly difficult situations.
You know, so you're kind of the straight man in this, Jonathan, so to speak. It's a hard job because you're walking that line and it's a very subtle performance in a lot of ways. You know, you're often the kind of big hunky guy in the front, you know, with hair, something like hair. This is the opposite of that performance, I would guess.
Totally.
Very hard? Is that to sublimate and to do that?
I don't know. I really loved it. I mean, I love sort of like getting to work with everyone. Like each week there was a different actor on set that had a different sort of style and a different sort of way of working. And it was so fun to sort of, to like be reactive and to sort of go on the journey of the character. Like you said, he's trying all these different things on. And so each week of the movie kind of felt like a different movie every time we were doing it. Like we were starting from the beginning again with a new cast member.
We would hit Monday and be like, can you believe it was like 2 days ago in the apple orchards? Like
now we're in a basement all the time. But it was really, I mean, these are incredible actors and it was really fun to work with them.
So you had to really stay open to everything.
Yeah.
You couldn't really define your character.
Right. I mean, like, acting is reacting, and so getting to experience and live it through the other people and sort of let their performances wash over you and let it affect you was really amazing. It made it easier than just sort of feeling like you're the Alice in Alice in Wonderland just watching all these crazy things happen, but to sort of be involved and, like, be connected with them was really cool.
Like, John is an incredibly defined character, but you have to decide when you're going to let him peek out and see the different layers.
You know, we talked about that a lot at the very beginning. Is we know where he ends up, and we know where they end up. So, and there are little landmines along the way when he drops the jade and breaks it. When the family tries to kick them out, there are moments when John suddenly, you know, rears his head. And it's not that that's the real person, and he's covering it all up. This is a person who's got a history of violence and a history of being out of control and a drinking problem, which he's in recovery. Mm-hmm. He's not a perfect human being. And so he's a tapestry, and he's a tattered tapestry. And in these moments, we see this stuff. But he did a brilliant job, I think, in editing that, because in performance, different takes would be different. We would do very, very violent takes, very, 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 you know, over-the-top takes.
And some more ominous stuff even before that really was it was about making the friendly stuff was always what poked through. Whenever I could get like a take that felt like really like kind of like loving of him almost is what always ended up working the best. You know, it was interesting.
And I think that's the great thing about this movie is that it's not easily categorized, nor is it easily summarized. You know, we can't say exactly what the lesson was in the scene with Curly. Mm-hmm. We can't say what the lesson was. There's not a lesson. This mm-hmm. is life.
So are you happy to get the David Sedaris seal of approval?
Yes, I'll put it on my tombstone.
So there's one actor missing that's really critical to the movie, which is the black woman at the beginning on the bus.
Oh, I have amazing. So many good stories about her. Her name is Tyra Richards.
She's amazing.
Her email was Miss Tyra Richards, which I loved so much. And I love her. We auditioned so many people for that part, so many people in LA and in Portland. I mean, upwards of like 100 something. No one auditioned for the movie. Like, you know, the lead parts. I didn't. Mm-hmm. My first film, I auditioned everybody. This movie, I didn't. I think I had that on my belt, and I just control. Like, I could be. I could like say, oh my god. I mean, I would only be so lucky. Like, why would I ever? What would I need to audition any of these people for? Like, I know what mm-hmm. they can do. Like, what would I get from that? I would want to talk to them before.
There's some other directors who are here.
Yeah.
Why would you audition?
Just give us the part. Their audition is their work, and I really believe that. You know. I really believe that, and so, but you know, that part was so specific and so difficult because it's the first thing in the movie. Like, how is it going to work? And we were like, maybe like 10 days away from shooting, we had nobody, and then my casting director forwards me an email, and it was just like a public YouTube link of her doing it. It was so good. It was such a relief because I thought the problem was maybe me. Like, I thought the problem was maybe that the scene wasn't actually funny, and she was the only one. Literally, there was no one else that could. There was no one else of like the 200, like 150 people. I've seen so many cute little innocent white girls read that dialogue. And it's so, and it was longer too. And she was like, also like very, she was like so, I wanted one specific thing from her, and I think she knew that when we talked. And she, every take, her performance, I could take like her audio from like any take and put it, lay it over another one. It was almost all identical, which is exactly what I wanted from her.
And she was the only one, she was the only actor on the set that was really like, between takes, she did not want to speak. She was very, very like in it to win it. She was very sweet at breakfast. We were chatting, and then we got on that bus, and she was like, "I mean, she was like really, like, she was really like,
yeah, yeah." She did that so perfectly, and she poor thing, she had to do her performance into a mirror because we were shooting it on the bus, so we couldn't get the camera behind. So we had to. So she was looking at herself while doing it, which is like so stressful because it was the only way to get. To be able to get, there was no room for the camera on the bus, and we couldn't rig it on the outside. So we had to shoot that whole thing into a mirror with her, and she handled it so well. And we had like an hour to do it too. So.
Well, it really is like to be or not to be. I mean, it's like she's hitting, trying to hit every note in that thing.
And yeah, it's a lot.
So
it's
many places and yeah. so much stuff going on.
And that's almost all verbatim from the story. I think I adjusted a couple of things. Like I don't think she like breaks down in the movie, and I thought, I mean, in the story, and I thought it would be really funny if she did in the film. But
mind of David Sedaris, though, some of that language is just shocking. It's truly shocking.
It's such a great opening.
Bush pussy. I want Bush. I hope what the phrase Bush pussy goes into like the common lexicon.
Bush pussy.
When she, she's like, I can't remember the exact phrase she says, but it's something about
Bush.
Something about Bush pussy. Oh. It's the funniest phrase.
You need to hook up with Pussy Riot the movie, and then you can have Bush
pussy.
Bush pussy is a great
in Russia.
It's such a good phrase. Bush pussy. Yeah, it's like you understand exactly what it means.
So how long ago did you guys shoot this?
What's that?
How long ago did you shoot?
A week and a half ago.
This
is wardrobe.
Yeah, honestly, we shot it really recently. I mean, we shot it October, November, in there. So, I mean,
so is it nice?
I'm not totally supposed to say that, but whatever.
Is it nice to come to Sundance with something that's that fresh still in your mind?
Crazy. Yeah, it feels like a dream. It feels like it can't actually be happening.
Truly. It's so much fun. Like for me, I was like, it was great. I loved going straight from set to editing to be able to finish it, a cut in time to share with the festival. And then I loved going straight from that, you know, once we found out, I literally, you know, had a few days, then I found out, and then it was like, okay, now I've got to like kick in a high gear and get it done. And so, I mean, I think I had like one holiday, you know, like Thanksgiving and like a couple days for Christmas, but it's been kind of nice. Like, who's to say that post-production shouldn't move at the same pace production does? Because you always, like, the restriction makes the work, you know, because post-production, I could have sat in my office for 6 months cutting this thing and going back and whatever. And it's nice to be like, you know what, the first day, I immediately cut the only three full scenes that got cut for the movie got cut the first day. I was like, okay, they're not going to work. And then you just go and just be bold with it. It was kind of, I liked it. I personally did. And I liked that it took a long time to get the movie together on a business front, a financial front, and everything. So putting it putting it together quickly was nice. I feel like I earned a little bit of the struggle, the struggle on the earlier back time.
And the movie is so about tone that, like, the fact that you actually got it quick in the editing room. I mean, this is the kind of movie you could really linger on.
The music is so good. The music that you added into the
music is fantastic.
Can you tell that story? You told it last night a little bit, but where did that all come from? Because it is shockingly interesting.
I was a percussionist in high school. Like, I loved studying music and percussion and.
Marching band, yes.
Okay. I did do marching band, and my sister was a percussion major at San Diego, and this minimalist composer, Steve Reich, lives in San Diego, so he was like a local hero, and she did this piece of his called Clapping Music that's a 20-minute piece with just two people clapping the same rhythm. One person claps the same rhythm for 20 minutes, the other person skips, moves it with a 30-second note every four measures, so it's the pattern shift. So he did all these really interesting experiments with minimalism, and so it was funny. It was the first day I was editing it. We were still in Portland. We were still like rapping, and I was like, oh, that's right. I should wonder what that stuff would sound like. And then it just started working so well. And then I needed something with a little more sincerity. And he had a piece that, even though it was clarinets, even though it was tonal instruments as opposed to percussion, he used them as percussion pieces, percussion instruments in there, never melodic. And it seemed great to like never dictate the tone too strongly, like encourage the tone. But then, obviously, not all of it fit well, not all of his work. So it was an old high school friend of mine that we used to play percussion together, like came over to my house, and we just went through and found, we used props from the movie. And
a lot of his body, right?
Yeah, he uses a body. All the stuff on the bus, all that music is just his mouth,
pop out with these weird sounds.
Yeah, and then we just experimented hitting the jade clock sometimes and just created stuff like that to make the sounds.
That's
in the
crazy.
It was a lot of fun. It was like fun because it felt like, it was like my old high school buddy that we used to do percussion. So it felt like we actually like went back. And then the banjo piece at the end, he's just like a musical. That was the first time he ever picked up a banjo in his life. And
what?
He had just,
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and it was like, it's like so beautiful and fits. It's the only time there's anything like melodic in the film that way. So
another thing, all of your castings, that I don't know whether you've been on Broadway. You've been in theater.
But I first saw Troian in theater at the Geffen in LA, though.
There you go.
So I saw before, I saw her on television, I'd seen her do this incredibly like complex play called Equivocation.
Oh, yeah. A Jesuit play.
Yeah.
Shakespeare.
Mm-hmm. So is going back and forth critical to all of you guys in terms of the instrument?
We were talking about that last night.
Yeah. You're saying, like, you know, you do a play for a while and you're like, oh man, I just want to make some money and do a TV show, and, you know, and then you're like, oh, this is so boring, and I don't want to do some movie. You know, each medium sort of scratches its own itch, but each medium has its limitations.
Yeah.
And so, you know, even obviously from director to director, you know, play to play, it's so refreshing to go from. It's basically about the size of the house you're playing to.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? When you're doing a movie, it's a house. You know, it's a little thing like that. And then when you're doing a play, you can. I think stretch your wings a little.
I think the great thing about also having theater as part of your training is that I know that for us theater actors, it's very important what the other person is giving you, and so. You know, the scene lives in between the people. When you're filming a camera situation, the other actor isn't on screen when you're filming, you know, maybe a piece of them, but to retain that sense of importance about what we're doing between us makes for a different kind of performance. Mm. People who only ever do TV or film, I think, sometimes are caught up in the image of, this is my close-up now, this is my shot, you can leave. I'm going to just focus on making sure that I'm right next to the lens and make sure I'm doing that thing with my eyebrow, which is great, except that this brings something to it. Mm. You have that performance energy. It does translate in a different way.
I struggle with that.
But Jonathan doesn't do the other side of the camera stuff anyway. So.
Yeah. He goes home.
Yeah.
He goes all body double.
Yeah.
He's tired.
But the body double has to wear a wig because no one else would have hair that amazing.
Yeah.
So.
And teeth caps.
But you know what, though? I learned on my first movie, I was naive about it. I was like, oh, of course an actor would know when they're on camera or not. And like everyone here was incredibly gracious when they weren't. You know, Jonathan in the last scene, we shot Dennis's stuff first, and Jonathan gave him tears in every take. It wasn't until I went up to the car after we'd done a couple of takes, I was like, oh, I didn't even realize. And it's so good that he did, because you turn to camera once and you actually see it. And if not, that would have been a kind of a distracting moment.
But that's sort of what you're talking to. I wasn't giving, like, it was like what you were giving me, actually. I wasn't like, oh, I knew I wasn't on camera, so I wasn't trying to like give a performance. Right. But what Denis was saying was so affecting that it was impossible
and
to
And
that's
not... so helpful to me, you know what I mean?
Right.
To see that you're being affected makes this performance go forward.
It's, yeah.
I wish, I did, my original plan was to hopefully shoot, I wanted to shoot the whole film with two cameras. Because of almost every scene in the movie, except for like the dinner table scene and the two, and then the factory women scene is between two people, and I just thought, wouldn't it be great to be able to do that, but we couldn't afford the two cameras the whole time, you know? But I would love to shoot a movie like Barry Ackroyd style one day and just have like seven cameras on set all the time. I don't like covering that much, but it was more just so that like, you know, I think it was actually like, someone told me once, like Tony Scott, like everyone would freak out because he wouldn't have rolled anything by lunch, but he was setting up all the cameras and then they'd start and he would roll two takes because just literally twice and had all the cameras rigged. And then they were done for the day because of every angle they had. So it was, you know, I do find that interesting. Like I like that idea. I want to do a movie that at some point where everyone is always on camera all the time, or at least could be. You know, I think, you know, where it's like, it's a little bit looser so that the actors might not know. I know that's how David O. Russell does things. Like, no one ever knows. That's why you watch it. Like, the camera's literally running around the room. I can't imagine editing his movies. I'm saying this as an editor. When I was editing this movie while Silver Linings Playbook came out, and you can tell in the coverage, like, oh my God, this must have been so hard to edit because he's getting something, like, genuine from it because you can tell he's just moving. He's probably, like, grabbing the camera himself and, like, running it around the room. And I don't know if I could ever do that, but I'd like to do something kind of in the middle of there, you know, between
you can start working with figures. And do, you know, have everybody doing everything all the time, and this one
all the cameras
in real time.
Yeah.
And
the Lars von Trier, had 100 cameras.
Well, I was supposed to shoot a single take movie before this one, and it ended up falling apart. And that was part of the aim was you could never stop acting, and we weren't going to stitch shots together or anything like that. We were going to do it genuine. It was
Mike actually did, I guess, that on composing paper. He ended up writing out the script.
Oh, really?
Because it was like supposed to be lyrical, like a music, almost like a loving musical.
Wow.
And they just went, and you can see, you know the space, I mean, I don't know if you've been in that building on Sunset Boulevard, but you can really tell how that space worked for them when they shot that movie. Shot the tape out.
Huh? What are you talking about? Time Code.
Time Code, yeah.
Okay, yeah, just making sure, yeah. It's like, it's funny, because I remember when After Russian Art came out, and I obviously re-researched a lot of this when I was supposed to do this one take movie. When Russian Art came out, everyone was like, oh, it's the first one take movie. And I was like, Mike Figgis did this, and he did it four times over, and at the same exact time, and there's like earthquakes in the movie. Like, so people had, the cameraman had alarm clocks so that when the earthquakes would hit, they would shake the camera. And I mean, if you watch closely, it doesn't totally work, but it's so ambitious. And I thought that, when it gets experimental like that, you know, I was trying to do a single take but have it play like genre, and which I thought would have been interesting to have it feel like a traditional genre movie, but where maybe the audience wouldn't even acknowledge that it was a single take. But then another movie came and did that here at Sundance.
Well, Les Mis is the only movie that anybody's ever sang on set, so.
Yeah.
You know. I think there were like four other movies this year that did it, but Les Mis is the first
ever.
No one has ever sung live on set before. Yeah.
So what was last night like for you all? Was it the first time everybody got to see the movie, I assume, outside of Kyle?
Yeah. Except Jonathan, he'd seen it before.
Yeah,
so scary or just the kind of like fun to go and see it actually happen?
I think it was a combination of all those things.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we all have anxiety about wanting to make sure people like us, like it. So anyone who shifted at the wrong time, you're like, oh, dude, don't move.
The bathroom breaks, those are always terrifying.
Yeah. You know, it's like you're watching TV in your house and you're on the show and your family's over and they're talking through it. And you're like,
yeah.
This is my line. You know, so it's a little bit of that going on, but also really gratifying to watch it play, to watch the laughs land. Mm. You know, a credit to editing and writing that the laughs were real, big, unified audience laughs, and not some bizarre dude in the corner going.
Although there was one.
I loved that though. I think I might have known who it was.
It was the one guy.
I think it was another
first
credit.
Something you said. Something Corey said. I can't remember what it was.
But you know what's funny? My favorite line that when I was screening it for small groups, that it's like my favorite line maybe in the whole movie is when he's like, I'm pretty sure it's illegal to steal a bathrobe in the state of Oregon.
That's a great line.
I find that line was I thought it was the funniest line in the story, and I remember, and it was when I've only been showing it to small groups, like little test screenings and asking them afterwards. I never really got much of a moment, but I think there was something about the group of people and like the intensity of that moment that then let the moment laugh. You know, it's like, it is a different experience watching it with that many people. Mm. So of course, I mean, there was the pressure of like Sedaris never having seen it, but even more so them, like they're the one, ultimately I'm not really on stage. I'm not, yes I am, and it was my work, but really they're the ones whose actual like appearances are there. So, you know, you want them to at least feel like, okay, that they were, that I was trying to be careful with their performance to make sure that they were never, none of them were ever you know, embarrassed with anything they did in it.
So you knew you had Sedaris when you finished, when it was over?
I knew.
Give you the thumbs up or whatever. What did he do?
He didn't know.
Smirk up?
Or, no, I said to people that had he come up to me and been like, oh, I loved it so much, that I would have known he would have been lying to me. Because not because he's cold, but because he's not like effusive like that. And so the fact that he was, instead was like thoughtful and like wanted to talk about like individual moments and had taken all these notes in his notepad and like wanted to discuss it, to me that was his way of indicating that he appreciated it. And he talked so much about how much he loved all of that too. So that was,
he was such a good sport.
Yeah.
He was like so present and just like, the fact that he didn't really, other than giving you the story, have anything to do with the movie as far as production, and like came and did interviews and took pictures and chatted with all of us, and he was such a great.
And he doesn't photograph like on his book tour, because he has to sign so many books. It's like a policy, like they have a sign up usually, not out of vanity on his end, but just out of like, if he took a photo with everyone and signed their books, like it would, no one would get, and he always waits till the very last person. Having said that, I mean, that's his life. He's always on tour. And so I would imagine this was a very different circumstance, where like the pre-party, he was being asked for that a lot. And I got a photo with him, and I've known him for 3 years now, and it's the first time I've ever gotten a photo with him. So it was strange. I'm glad I got it. I felt bad for asking, but I'm glad it's there too. So
I thought about it too and didn't do it.